method of teaching here on this platform, whatever you call it, Twitter or X or whatever else. A really quick thank you to VisualDx for all the images that we're going to use today. So I wanted to share my approach to a rash, and this is hopefully the first in a series of teaching modules that I'll put out. But the first thing I always look for is the primary lesion. So as a reminder, the primary lesion is the most basic building block of a rash or a lesion. So that would be something like a macule or a patch or a papule or a plaque. And in this case, what we're looking at are vesicles, so fluid-filled lesions that are less than a centimeter in diameter. And we're also seeing bulla, which are fluid-filled lesions that are greater than a centimeter in diameter. And whenever I see a vesicle or a bulla, or putting it together, a vesicle bullous eruption, the next question I have is the level of the split. Is this split in the skin that's causing this vesicle bullous eruption occurring within the epidermis or under the epidermis or subepidermal? And the way that you tell that is whether it is a tense or a flaccid blister. So a tense blister, something that stands tall and proud like this, is more likely to be at the subepidermal level, more likely to be in the pemphigoid group, versus a superficial process that's in the epidermis that is going to look more flaccid and droopy, that's more in the pemphigus group. And a good side-by-side comparison is here. So our original eruptions on the left-hand side, you can see they're all standing tall and proud. If you did actually try something called a Nikolsky, which is where you push laterally against a blister, you would see that it is Nikolsky negative because it is a subepidermal process. You can't create a blister just from rubbing next to a blister. Versus the picture on the right-hand side, this is a case of pemphigus. So pemphigus is intraepidermal, and if we actually did rub next to the blister or do a Nikolsky exam, it would be a positive Nikolsky because you would be able to recreate a blister on the side. And more importantly, the blister itself is flaccid. You can see the wrinkles here, so it's a little bit droopier. You can almost see that it's kind of falling down a little bit over here. This is also a droopy process, so this is also flaccid as well. Really quick caveat, any blister that's tense, if it sits alone for about 3 days, it will turn flaccid. So you want to make sure that if you are trying to evaluate a new vesicle bullous process, that you are looking at a new fresh lesion. Okay, so we've established here that this is a tense bullous eruption, and in addition to that, it is probably Nikolsky negative. So we're dealing with something in the pemphigoid group, something where there's a split in the skin at the subepidermal level around the basement membrane zone. So for those of you who have looked at my modules or tweets or tutorials on the skin exam, after the primary lesion, we want to look at secondary chain. So we're seeing a little bit of crusting, which is not surprising because you see some serous drainage will come from these bulla. And then the third step is configuration. So what does this look like? Are they in lines or linear? Are they in annular configurations? Are they polycyclic, serpiginous? And in this case, I would highlight that this eruption is quite annular. So you see this circle of tense bulla, and here in a different photo where we're looking at it on lighter skin, also a circle or an annular configuration of tense bulla as well. And then after the configuration question is distribution, where on the body this is. Distribution, reminder, is usually the least important of your physical exam characteristics. In this particular case, we're looking at this on the left forearm, just to put a side-by-side of lighter skin and darker skin, just to highlight on the exam, the erythema, as I always harp on, is a little bit more noticeable, is much more noticeable on the left-hand side in lighter skin, whereas in darker skin, you're going to see the erythema present as more hyperpigmentation and sometimes more violaceous, or in this case, it kind of blends into the background. It's a little bit harder to notice. It's still there, but you have to make sure that you look for it. So this side-by-side comparison is a really great example of how different skin tones can really affect the exam in terms of color, but the rest of the exam is the same. You have an annular eruption of tense bulla. So this is quite a striking exam. The other thing I always tell my trainees, my residents, and my men students is to really look at the whole picture and use all the clues. So in this picture on the left, you're also seeing that there's a hospital gown or a Johnny, and you're also seeing a bunch of monitors, including a pulse ox. So this particular patient is probably in the hospital, an inpatient, which just raises the question of maybe a potential drug-induced process because they're probably being exposed to a lot of new medications. So what exactly is this? So we know that it's a tense blistering process. It's in the pemphigoid group. It's happening in this annular configuration. So this is going to raise the question of linear IgA. So linear IgA is a pemphigoid group disease, where autoantibodies are directed towards the 97 kilodalton portion of bullous pemphigoid antigen 2, also known as BP180. So I understand this is probably more pertinent to those of you who are in dermatology residency, who have to memorize this stuff for our boards. But this is what the hemidesmosome looks like, right? So up top, we're looking at the bottom of the keratinocyte in the epidermis. And then down here, we're looking more at the basement membrane zone. Bullous pemphigoid 180 is this purple transmembrane protein that extends across the lamina lucida, the lightest color that you would see under electron microscopy. The important part is that the 97 kilodalton portion is here extracellularly, and this is the target that the antibodies will go for in linear IgA. So this can be drug-induced, which is why that first patient being in the hospital is important, because you would think about things like vancomycin, which is the most common drug culprit. Other things have been reported, including other antibiotics, immunosuppressants like cyclosporin, antihypertensives like captopril. The point is that there's a lot of different things reported, but it can also be idiopathic. It can even be paraneoplastic. It happens in kids. It happens in adults. Ultimately, a good tip from a dermatology residency perspective is anytime you see something that's IgA, you think about neutrophils as the white cell or immune cell of choice. And if you're thinking about neutrophils, you might choose an anti-neutrophilic treatment of choice, which would be dapsone or colchicine. And of course, if it's drug-induced, you want to stop the offending agent. So great question here is, why is it called linear IgA when all these bulla are appearing in annular configurations? Maybe it should be called annular IgA. The reason is because of the way it was named. So it was named because of its pattern on direct immunofluorescence. So as a reminder, direct immunofluorescence is where you take the patient's skin and you incubate it with a particular solution that has antibodies that will go tag other antibodies that are already on the sample and then light up with immunofluorescence. So here, this is the patient's skin, and you're seeing that it's lit up at the basement membrane zone or at the bottom of the epidermis. And this lighting up is actually specific for IgA. So what we've identified here is that the antibody that has the immunofluorescent tag is targeting IgA. And so we know that it's IgA that's in a linear pattern, causing a linear pattern on the DIF, which is why this disease ended up being called linear IgA. Bullous pemphigoid would have a similar pattern, except you would know that it's a linear deposition of IgG as opposed to IgA. And so that's the reason why this disease is called linear IgA. So that's all I'm going to cover today. I wanted to be a little bit more bite-sized and hopefully high yield for all levels of training, including those of you who may be seeing skin on your admitted patients, those of you who are just learning dermatology, and also those of you who are in dermatology residency who might find some of the minutiae a little bit more pertinent to your studies as you prepare for the boards. Give me some feedback. Let me know how you like this method of teaching. And again, thank you to VisualDx for all of the photos. And until next time, thank you for joining.